Hi everyone, this is Kieran from Proust Astrology, and I think I have a special one for you this time. I've long wanted to get around to doing an astrobiography of French author Marcel Proust, but that of course has taken a long time, as there are no shortcuts with this guy. So I've invested that time, and this gave me the opportunity to almost finish reading the unbelievably long novel, started years ago, and decided that now it was time to come towards the end of it. But I've also watched the films that have been inspired by this novel. Proust was a Cancer sun sign, and now that the sun is in Cancer, we are past the solstice and well into the sign. He was born July 10th, and there was a new moon in Cancer on the 28th of June. I think it's the perfect time to realize more fully all that Cancerians have to offer us and what we can learn from them, which I think is something to do with getting in touch with the ebb and flow of the moon and our internal flow, and to cherish the things that we love much more the way a Cancerian would. Other Cancerians that I've covered on this site are Dr. John Dee and David Hockney. You see that there's a new archives page on my site. You'll find the links there if you want to read about those two. What's interesting though is, as I thought about this, is that Dee spent a long time looking into a black scrying stone and seeing visions of angels, and Hockney spent an equally a long time looking into his camera obscura mirror, doing a study of the optical tricks that painters used in the Renaissance. And so Proust likewise looked into his cup of tea and with his Madeleine, not to read the tea leaves so much, not on that level, but to unlock the secrets of time and to see his whole life writ large there through a kind of inner meditation. So I think all three of these people are magicians in their different ways, artists and magicians. So the way I've done it is I've expanded a little bit on the style of astrobiography, so it covers quite a lot of ground. It attempts to see the life and the astrology as weaving together with other subjects, as astrology is only one strand among many. And you'll find the astrological observations and chart analysis woven more and threaded through into the life experience. But I'm also experimenting with this form of the audiovisual essay, still getting used to it, as I think it can hopefully take us beyond the print medium into a much more personal experience, you know, including photos, imagery, paintings, and even the music Proust loved. So they say that people are changed by reading Proust. Life is forever after, Proustian in some way. Your life could become more perceptive, more acute, more attuned to the cycling back of memory. You could develop, like Proust, a heightened sense of your position in society, which is perhaps lower than you want it to be, but can be altered through networking. You may be impelled to slow down, stop and reflect when you eat something like a madeleine or a tartine or any piece of cake, and to sip tea and relish the sensation more than before, to just pay more attention to the simple events and sensations. Or you could be flooded with memories which cannot ever fully be possessed, as the original moment that triggered the memory is gone. Another way to describe this is with the trendy word mindfulness, becoming more aware, and it's a good time now to do this by staying at home and in your nest, your sanctuary. And Proust was advocating this for a long time, over a century before the mindfulness industry even cranked into gear. What he proposed was that our everyday rituals and routines can be transformed into a Proustian act, which is a kind of sacrament, where even a solid cup of Yorkshire tea or a jammy dodger will suffice. The tea is just the trigger for the mind to do its thing and open up the cabinet of memories, dreams, and reflections. The result of that is a massively increased awareness of life. Proust has Neptune conjunct the ascendant, and this is the most obvious signature of an artist, or mystic, or both in his case. It stands at the doorway of the chart, and so people probably perceived him first as immensely sympathetic, kind, concerned about them, and only afterwards leaving the smoky aftertaste. His Neptune is in Aries, where it will go in March 2025. But that made him a leader of this world, but not quite wholly in it. I think he floated through his societal engagements and all the disappointments caused acute suffering, and through that suffering he created art. He was a pioneer of sorts as an Aries ascendant, but his real territory of exploration was his inner world. He may have been present at those parties of dukes and duchesses and been devoted to his friends, but while he was talking to them, he was somewhere else in a deep state of reverie and reflection in this liminal space lacking any boundaries. His Neptune is trine to Saturn in Capricorn and square to the Sun and Mercury in the home base of Cancer in the fourth house. So all of this acted as a stimulus to his great work. Any link at all between Saturn and Neptune points to huge artistic talent, as the art is born from the suffering and struggles that Saturn creates in the artist's life. Liz Green compiled a long list of romantic era musicians, composers, who exhibit this romantic attitude, from Albanus, Bach, Chopin, to Vivaldi and Wagner. And she found that they had almost all got a configuration of Neptune and Saturn aspects in their charts. This is not Gokilan style statistical analysis, but simply seeing the common pattern there. So there's something spiritual about Proust, not religious so much as tending towards the mystical ability to see the divine in daily trivia, in ordinary events, that this search for lost time became his salvation. It's well known that responses to Proust can be over the top, where people became zealous converts belonging to a kind of cult. Walter Benjamin translated him into German, but was afraid of the influence of Proust's style, that it would smother his own style, so he stopped reading him. Virginia Woolf said reading Proust was, for her, almost sexual. Proust can take over the mind of readers so that the boundary becomes blurred between the writer and the reader, as he can make his thoughts sound so familiar they are like your own. But this transformation of becoming more Proustian depends on actually reading the 3,200-page novel. That's 1,200,000 words of À la recherche du temps perdu. For that, you need patience and time, and as you may never get around to it, or you may start but never get to the end, or have what is very common, long sentence phobia. Proustian sentences are famously spiraling and serpentine and can stretch across two or three pages, which to me is the very antithesis of a tweet on Twitter. But the ebb and flow of these words is just like the moon that rules Cancer. The paradox is that time spent reading Proust is never wasted, even if you manage to get to the end of one of the longer sentences and achieve understanding of its intended meaning, because then you might have that kind of epiphany that readers of Proust love, his sagacity made luminous by Jupiter in Cancer, its sign of exaltation, where the nuggets of wisdom just flow on the page and are nourished by an emotional warmth. They are part of a quest, and they bestow a more positive and generous outlook than any other sign, even though Cancer can still remain thrifty. So Proust was born on July 10th, 1871 in the sign of Cancer, with Moon in Taurus and Ascendant in Aries. So he has Earth, Fire and Water all very well represented, but not much air. The moon is tranquil in Taurus, definitely, and relishes simple pleasures like these repeated cups of tea, with quiet contemplation on a park bench or at a music concert. That's very Taurian. He also was simple, although complicated. He admired kindness in others above cleverness, even though he himself was clever, and rules of politeness mattered to him, along with sensitivity to others, graciousness and generosity. He would take pains to answer the questions of others rather than talk about himself. What I'm seeing is Neptune is so strong, however, as also the esoteric ruler of Cancer, that it presided over all his social exchanges. The North Node is also at the zero point of Cancer, which is very powerful, indicating this life, which was to develop an acute emotional intelligence. And what makes this Cancerian truly a Cancer in the classic sense was that as a little boy, Marcel could not go to sleep without his mother's kiss, as explained in the book. The highly educated Jeanne Proust, his mother, was a Taurus, and she worried about him being too dependent on her. And there are echoes here of Melanie Klein's theories of object relations and Bowlby's theory of attachment. This is the psychological trap that in early development we develop complexes that emerge to bite us in our relationships later in life. We may act out the mother archetype without realizing. Proust was close to his mother, as everyone noted. Thoughts passed between them without barriers. Yet one critic was able to say that the love of the mother includes the hatred of the mother. Her Uranus, Pluto, conjuncts his ascendant Neptune, and her sun falls on his moon in Taurus. So to say that she was influential is an understatement. But as in all relationships, there was a mixture of smooth and challenging between them. Cancerian feelings must be protected and secure at all costs, similar to Taurus. So this idea, though, I think in Proust is represented by the moon, which rules his sun sign, making him much more emotional than at first expected, and where emotional nuance was the whole purpose of his life. And this is concentrated further by being in the fourth house of home, where we find his Jupiter, Mercury, Sun, and Uranus. His philosophy of life is that which is unlocked by the key of memory, especially in its involuntary form, which is not ordinary recall, but depth recall. So he treated his own past as a kind of treasure trove, a museum full of objects. And the sign of Cancer is associated with collectors. They are the lifelong creatures of libraries, archives, collections, and museums. Proust was diligent and painstaking in his collection of impressions of people that he encountered, all of which he sifted through, carefully catalogued, and used as ciphers in his great work, In Search of Lost Time, or as sometimes it's translated as Remembrance of Things Past. Proust's appeal is subtle and slow. His words have a peculiar way of worming their way into your mind, and they leave an imprint. His elongated sentences have a weft and warp into an overall flow. So you'd imagine he had an elevated Mercury, and that's true. It's prominently conjunct the sun in Cancer at combust, less than 1 degree. So there is an explosion of words and thoughts, especially since this conjunction is sandwiched between Jupiter and Uranus on either side. They're all nestled in the fourth house of self and ancestors, and Jupiter there lends this grandiosity to his sense of heritage here, or to a kind of opulence of the furnishings of his home, being from an illustrious family, or it could speak of foreign connections and travels. He did know a lot of diplomats, but Proust made very few journeys. He was not himself aristocratic, but from reading him, you'd think he was, as he writes, with insider knowledge of all the elite families, including the Rothschilds. Yet he was more like a homebody, as many Cancerians are. They rarely stray far from home. He was in fact, fond of Normandy, which is not very far from Paris, but otherwise did not travel much. The one exception was to Italy. Once he became a follower of the English art critic John Ruskin, he ventured as far as Venice to experience the understanding of that city's exquisite Gothic style in his own way. And some say that Proust's novel is structured with the same intricacy and precision as a great cathedral. That's Neptune on the ascendant again. But in his astrolocation chart, his Sun and Mercury runs through Florence and his Jupiter runs through Paris, but it meets Neptune closer to the border with Belgium, and that's where he used to spend a lot of his time on the coast. So these words on the page flow and can begin to sound more like music. And Proust is a very good example of Walter Pater's thesis that all art aspires to the condition of music. His novel was actually called Roman Fleuve, a river novel, because of its length and its endless circularity. It's dipping into infinity. As you can start reading anywhere, pick it up again anywhere. So again, Neptune reigns supreme here, as it's right there at the portal of his chart and on an angle. All his angles actually are cardinal, so these are forceful initiatory energies, and that would have been very powerfully activated throughout his life during every transit across the first, fourth, seventh, and tenth houses. The ascendant is in Aries too, pushing forward and wanting to lead. So while he may have appeared soft, he was in fact quite forceful. Neptune is porous, so it dissolves what it touches and becoming invisible, taking a back seat, so adds a little bit of paradox. And it's true to say that he pioneered this modernist style of ponderous, meandering thoughts and the river narrative. So he was pioneering in a way, but he did it his way, which is very Aries ascendant, by going deep inside himself, beyond the surface perceptions. His style was recognized publicly in December 1919, when the Sun was in Sagittarius, when he won the Prix Goncourt. This was when both his progressed Sun and Mercury had arrived in the sign of Sagittarius, the home of publishing and honors. But his progressed Moon was conjunct Pluto in Cancer, and this conjunction was also conjunct his natal part of fortune. So this was all very promising for his reputation. And by the following year, 1920, the progressed Moon had also arrived in Sagittarius, ruled by Jupiter. So I think there's a sense that his reputation was becoming well established as a unique writer, and that he was known beyond France and into the rest of the world. So when thinking of Proust's loves and hates, it's good to bear in mind that he was a sun sign Cancer, which tends to move sideways and can be clingy like a crab. It is watery, emotional and protective, and a little bit complex. So Proust's love life was complex. He adored women as companions, he even idolized them, and he ran after the ones with boyish looks such as Colette. But at the same time, he discreetly had relationships with men, such as Reynaldo Hain, who was a Leo, Lucien Daudet, who was Gemini, and Alfred Agostinelli, who was a Libra. Probably no woman could compete with his mother, He was inconsolable when she died, and his friends believed he might go mad with grief. His Venus was picky in the early degrees of Virgo, landing in the sixth house, so perhaps he was never easily satisfied, and his daily social relations became the center of his life. Yet Mars was also in Libra, and able to be the great mediator in conflicts, but also in their sixth, so probably the source of a lot of irritation and allergies that affected his health. It feels uneasy to please here. And with an Aries ascendant, he probably caused conflicts himself through putting himself first or through excessive fastidiousness. Han was a music composer from Venezuela who had studied with Saint-Saëns, and with him, love was more mutual for Proust. They even had the idea to write a biography of Chopin together. Han was very aware of Proust's sensitivity and was responsive to Proust's shifting moods and health. His Chiron moon is on Proust's ascendant Neptune and moon. His asteroid Eros conjuncts Proust's Pluto, so their intimacy might have been explosive. With a strong Mercury ruling both the MC and the ascendant, Han was after all fluent in several languages. He was the one who actually encouraged him to take his writing seriously. But Proust was complicated, and according to Edmund White, for Proust, passion was a nagging need that became only more demanding as the more it was denied. Indeed, Proust would drive away all his lovers, in his fiction as in his life, through his unreasonable demands. This hints at the cloying nature of the Cancer native, who once hold of someone does not like to let go, and yet may even be perversely spurred on by rejection. When talking of Albertine, it plays out very much like Carmen's motto, "If you love me, I don't love you." In love, Proust said, "We choose badly." Another of Proust's lovers or obsessions was Alfred Agostinelli, a Libran, who was the model for Albertine in the book. He was the driver and mechanic in Proust's employment and a happily married man by all accounts. They met when Alfred was around in his early teens. They too had a powerful synastry to the nodes and major planets. Agostinelli had a boisterous and fun-loving Mars and Jupiter in Sagittarius. He was noted as a motoring enthusiast, and his nickname by Proust was the Nun of Speed. Perhaps it was too much adventure, as these connections triggered the Chiron links too, causing loss and pain. Agostinelli's life ended tragically, aged 26, in a plane crash where he drowned in the Mediterranean. Proust had even predicted that this obsession with machinery and the steering wheel would be his death throes. But he offers a kind of solution for the paradox of suffering that Chiron brings to us by saying that the best defense of all against suffering is to live it to the full. Proust could also make enemies, and Cancer never backs down from a lifelong feud. Since Mars is the ruler of Proust's chart, we'd expect some difficulties in friendship, as it is in Libra, ruled by Venus. But even though he was a dandy and idler, he did have a duel, an actual shootout with guns, with author Jean Lorraine, who was a Leo. Their synastry is fascinating, as Lorraine's Mars moon happens to land on Proust's sun in the middle of the sign of Cancer. They were mortal enemies, and that feud endured a long time. Proust was defending his honor and his private love affair with Lucien Daudet that Lorraine said should be publicly acknowledged. The bullets in the duel of dandies missed their mark, however, and Lorraine's Mars is also opposite Proust's Chiron in the 12th house, so the point of tension at which this suffering made him most vulnerable to such enemies as Lorraine is evident there in the 12th house. Lorraine aimed at forcing Proust to own up to his tastes in the bedroom and not hide behind heterosexual protagonists in his stories. The other stereotype is that Proust was a total snob, and that, but that in itself is in a way snobbish to say that we shouldn't read what snobs have written. those who are adamant that you should only read à la recherche in the original French too, or not at all, are similar to the characters in the book who look down on others as inferior pond life. You can enjoy Proust in English, as he is better than a lot of writers, so his writerly qualities translate very well. However, you might say that to add the elegant sonorities of the French language are missing in the English translation. But the loss is the same if you don't read it at all in either language. One reason not to miss out is that it can be surprisingly hilarious. The way these snobs are observed and satirized, it can be acerbic comedy. And the worst thing a snob can do is to pretend not to be one, and Proust loved to point that out. But as James Joyce, an Aquarius, said after meeting Proust, it was not such a meeting of great minds. To Joyce, Proust talked about way too many duchesses. But the duchesses are there to pinpoint the foibles of human psychology, as Proust cannot help exposing their flaws. Yet Proust himself was subject to the snobbery of André Gide in 1913, when after misreading a sentence, Gide rejected Proust's submission to the Nouvelle Revue Française, and this triggered yet another lifelong antagonism. Gide, a late Scorpio with a moon in Cancer, called Proust an idler, an arriviste, and a snob. But that situation was reversed, and Gide was forced to eat his words and personally apologize to Marcel. In January 1914, Gide sent a groveling letter just when Pluto was transiting Proust's North Node and all the planets in Capricorn were opposed to his planets in Cancer. While these letters were written in polite phrases, the standoff was very real. Gide's ascendant conjuncts Proust's Mars and squares his Sun Mercury. Anyone like Proust with Mars squared Jupiter and Saturn, a T-square of big players, would be dealt a hand in life that is full of challenges and tensions. These are the three contrary energies. So all tied together, they would have stimulated a more Proust life, in lockstep, being in square and opposition quite a lot of the time. But as his chart progressed into Leo, he perhaps became more accepted in the literary world. And as we said, by 1919, the moon was on its way into Sagittarius. By 1920, it was there. Proust loved reciting posh names. He tirelessly lists the aristocratic names and titles, not as the would-be longing to be part of the elite, but as a magician would the magical incantations and the barbarous words from a dusty old grimoire. It is certain that Proust had occult knowledge, and when one scene Proust describes the Baron de Charlus' behavior as like a magician, deep in the concentration of willpower on his subjects, they were usually valets, servants, and assistants, young and attractive, when he was reading them like a book of spells. So Scorpio partially rules Proust's eighth house, so he's a natural in the terrain for going deep. Proust also had this quality. His entire philosophy could be stated as an intricate web of correspondences and synchronicities, almost as clearly linked as in the Kabbalah. Some even say that there was astrology lurking behind the scenes. For example, when the Baron de Charlus lets down his hyper-virile public face and behaves slightly effeminately, mocking his female relatives, he is said to do so, quote, under the transit of Venus Androgyne. That the future casts a shadow on the present is also a theme, and I wonder if Proust had been an astrologer, he would have been able to give us a much deeper understanding of time and an even more astonishing novel. And he would have found a way to be less bound by time's restrictions by playing with it as a tool for insights. It is true to say, though, he was driven by something to complete his work before he died. So this suggests to me that he was very in touch with his daimon or genius, otherwise known as the lot of spirit. And this was at 9 degrees of Aquarius in his chart. So in modern astrology, that would be ruled by Uranus. And he certainly was Uranian in that sense. He was the ambassador for all Uranians and progressive in his thoughts. And the work that he created was original in its scope. But since traditional astrology would not use Uranus at all, the daimon would probably have been more Saturnian, Saturn. Saturn rules this part of the chart. And would have been the hardest of taskmasters, egging him on to do his great work before he died. And this is what we know about the daimon, or the lot of spirit. It's that urge in people that drives them towards their ultimate direction for lifetime achievement, whether they like it or not. And sometimes they have to be put back on track by the daimon, who speaks in symbols and life events. So there's a good deal of rumination on death in Proust. Is death preordained, or can we change the timelines, he seems to ask. He hints that Robert Saint-Loup almost went willingly to his death and reflects almost like an astrologer on the nuances of fate and destiny here, how that reaches our awareness. Though he does not use the terminology of astrologers, such as the Daimon or Haiman Mene, the goddess of fate and destiny, he does a good job of describing this contradictory feeling in this quote. And may it not be possible that accidental death too is somehow recorded in advance, known only to the gods, invisible to men, but revealed by peculiar sadness, half unconscious, half conscious, and even insofar as it is conscious, proclaimed by others, with that complete sincerity with which we foretell misfortunes, which in our heart of hearts we believe we shall escape, but which will nevertheless take place. To the man who bears and forever sees within himself, as though it were some heraldic device, a fatal date. He's talking of a man who is filled with a sense of purpose, going to the trench warfare in northern France during World War I. This elevates his character from the usual trivial pursuits and is like a blossoming, a fruition. This knowledge comes to some people, is of how to free the will from the karmic elements of life through understanding this haimarmony, which is the potential offered to people who to gain wriggle room and not to be so much bound by fate or to accept it, unless we do accept our lot in life. And that comes to free the will from its ties that bind us. It's as though fate gives us this higher understanding that we are fulfilling a higher or more collective purpose, and that brings a kind of freedom. Proust himself also did military service and actually liked it, but acted quite like a regal dandy in aristocratic circles, perhaps even pompously with that Jupiter in the fourth. And yet he also was ultra cautious, so held back by Saturn, propelled forward by Mars, and expanded in all directions by kingly Jupiter, all in square relationship. He talks a lot about war, but this Mars in Libra would have gifted him with the art of compromise, as we mentioned before, so he would have been able to see different sides of the dispute and not so impulsive in argument. He probably would have reasoned his way out of them diplomatically. But that it also is in the sixth points, again, as we mentioned, to numerous allergies that bothered him on a daily basis. And Mars is well known to inflame the body and cause conflicts with co-workers in the sixth house. Saturn is about time, the old Kronos, and it's strong in its own sign of Capricorn. It has that CEO quality there and aims to become a master of his world for good or ill. This heavy but hard-working planet rests on the midheaven, and his book swarms with observations about time. It's almost an original thesis on the subject. In fact, Proust is the novelist most associated with this new psychological understanding of time, akin to Freudian analysis. Freud was his contemporary. For him, time was the tool of his art, which is why he's ideal to read when you have time on your hands. He stirs the pool of time to stretch it so to become a more amoeboid phenomenon, just like Jupiter enlarges the boundaries. But there are also some scenes of sexual bondage which could relate to Saturn in the novel, especially around the Baron de Charlus, this complex character. Proust and his narrator were all for showing the foibles of lovers as they sought the latest bout of jealousy or the latest fetish, from whips, chains, to iron beds, to rats in cages, or to show how they craved to possess their lovers and restrict their freedom till it kills with love, as Swan kills his love for Odette through jealousy and obsessional moods. So there we have the influence of Jupiter, abundance, making time, Saturn, more elastic. And there's also a kind of scientific analysis of human behavior that might please some but shock others, because it's always got this determined objectivity, which took quite a lot of courage to write about in those times. His father was an epidemiologist specializing in cholera, so this Saturn may point to his father, as well as the Daimon. The irony is that he reveled in exposing what others did, but never admitted to it himself, for the sake of his parents, to protect their reputation. And that baffled many, including André Gide and Jean Lorrain. But everyone in his close circle knew of Proust's personal tastes. And on time, the word perdu in the title implies time is not just lost, but also wasted. Ritual and rehearsal, anticipation and reflection and recollection are all about the discovery to become more dedicated to art through exploring involuntary memory. And this, he said, was his life's work, to produce art in the highest sense, as that fulfills life's purpose more than any other activity. And this was his real daimon. With all this seriousness and snobbery, you'd think that Proust had no sense of humour. Yet there's a lightness to Proust's style that extracts the heaviness out of the equation. And a huge amount of wittiness too, that adds sparkle to it and produces a few belly laughs. Who would think that A la Recherche can be a laugh out loud sort of book, but it is. That would be, I think, the Sun conjunct Mercury conjunct Uranus, that it elevates the mindless chit-chat from mere dinner table anecdotes to a fine sense of the human comedy. The jokes are so liberally sprinkled throughout. His wit, which was remarked on in his time, now endures after his death. The wit is palpable but also lucid, and accompanied by flashes of insight that are filtered through the warmth of sign of Cancer. So his comments are not always as caustic as they could be if Mercury was, say, for example, in Scorpio. But he did love to poke fun and expose foibles with a well-developed sense of mischief. But he also loved to nurture people and make fuss of them. He had a nose especially for how love makes fools of people. He thought time was actually wasted on conversation and preferred being solitary, as being alone expanded his ability to generate deep insights and his ability to write them. This alone, not status, wealth, or aristocratic connections, or even love affairs and friendships, he said, the pursuit of art gifted him with this profound and long-lasting engagement with life. not anything else. But with Uranus conjunct Mercury, could have affected his health as well, with increased nervous complaints. And sure enough, Proust suffered immensely from severe asthma. Mercury rules the lungs, especially towards the end of life, where his neurasthenia kept him bedridden. We mentioned the allergies, and he attempted to line his room with cork to muffle the noise, so his sensitivities were so acute. And Mars in the sixth creates maximum irritation with daily routines. He was, in fact, a sickly war baby born during the Franco-Prussian War, when people were starving on the streets of Paris and food was scarce. When Neptune was also on the ascendant, and that would have made him an ultra hypersensitive baby, uncertain about his health. But he was such a social observer and a dissector of society, almost with the zeal of an amateur botanist or an ornithologist. Perhaps he saw writing novels in this scientific way with Saturn on the MC. That he was also Jewish and homosexual gave him this ability to penetrate society's games of status and hypocrisy as a double outsider. Some said he was even ambivalent about his mother being a Jew. He makes weird reference to Saturn's outrider in Cities of the Plain, page 31, when explaining different types of men who like men. And this reads startlingly honest, fresh, and non-judgmental to today's readers. Most likely he meant bi-Uranian, as was, that was the common word used then for those who preferred their own sex. And since Chiron had not been discovered there, it is as if Chiron also, which is the scapegoat, occupies this theme in the novel, because he mentioned Dreyfus several times, and Dreyfus was the classic scapegoat of French society during the time of his trial at the end of the 19th century. So his novel was close to what was called A Stream of Consciousness, and critics called it the Nile of Language. But it also causes confusion and frustration in readers, as it's a kind of rabbit hole into which you fall like Alice, or like a mountain you have to climb. His work fails to be abridged. The longest sentence in Cities of the Plain has 958 words. So that's definitely long. Monty Python did a famous sketch which was called the All England Summarized Proust Competition, where an odd bunch of contestants stood in front of a Proustometer, and they were obliged to condense the whole of Proust into 15 seconds. But the mockery of Proust is also a kind of badge of honor, and his and admiration for Proust's monumental achievement is there because he proves the task impossible. Not one of the contestants can get past the first volume. Four volumes of In Search of Lost Time were published before his death, and then the rest emerged posthumously. 100 years on, and his reputation has grown, establishing this novel as probably the best of the 20th century, according to some critics. You can argue with that. His chart was a nocturnal chart, so he was born at 11:20 p.m., and almost all the planets are below the horizon, apart from Saturn. So there's this sense that in creating his cork-lined room, which he did at the Boulevard Haussmann, that he was creating his own tomb. Sign of Cancer is the cosmic womb, so from womb to tomb appears to be the span of life to death. He even called it an ark, like Noah's Ark. The cork was supposed to keep out the noise of Paris from outside, and also act as a barrier against pollen and dust that triggered his asthma and allergies. But there's a little bit of a myth here. The legend is that he died in this room, but actually he didn't because he had to move out. But he couldn't take the cork with him. He actually tried to sell the cork to a cork maker for a wine merchant, again emphasizing the Neptune in the chart, because it couldn't easily be removed. So to his death, he suffered even more in the new apartment. That Pisces rules his 12th house and that Chiron is there explains quite a lot. This is the kind of native that retreats to the cave of his bedroom and possibly whose creativity is stimulated through illness. His ideas came out of quietness and darkness, and he became a recluse. So he wrote only at night and he attempted to sleep during the day. He wrote in a semi-recumbent position, using his knees as a desk. So he would have drifted in and out of consciousness, inhabiting a liminal space there between worlds. That probably encouraged a melancholy state of mind, no doubt, and increased his hypersensitivity. So even though Proust Chiron was in Aries, Pisces still rules the 12th house here. So the Neptune theme is predominant again. We get a flavor of these Piscean issues, which would have been with religion and faith. He didn't appear to have one, but my guess is that he felt that he was a victim of society, especially this high society that he was so obsessed with, and that he was somehow a martyr to it, and that was his religion, his cult. And the Chiron in Aries bit is where he felt forever weakened in his physical form. He was already known and had received accolades upon his death by pneumonia, and that was in 1922 on November 13th. But it was still only a small circle of followers, but he had written most of the rest of the novel before he died, because he wanted to be sure to leave his mark on the world. The chart on the day of his death has a lot of pointers that times were difficult and could be bumpy for him. Again, I don't pay that much attention to death charts. They usually do have a lot of conflicting aspects, but that could be just potentials. So many other factors would indicate an actual death. But if we wanted to see, there is the transiting Saturn that was conjunct his natal Mars, which opposed his Chiron. Transiting Sun was opposite his natal Pluto. Transiting Pluto was approaching his natal Sun. So I think if it hadn't happened then, it would have happened just a few months later. And at this point in November of that year, 1922, 100 years ago now, that it would have been almost exactly conjunct his natal Jupiter. So what's hard to miss is that he died as if having a prearranged appointment with Chiron. He was 51. That was his Chiron return. And they say Chiron in Aries tend to be the forged in the fire type of people. That generation that suffered hugely was the post-World War I generation. So from 1918 to 1927, when Chiron was in Aries, they were the ones who felt left behind by all the destruction of World War I, but where they had to pick up all the pieces and just carry on and go into that so-called Roaring Twenties period. So Proust was buried at Père-Lachaise Cemetery, where people can still visit the grave. I think it's relatively modest compared to others in that cemetery. So to keep returning to this Neptune on the ascendant, this to me points to the fact that Proust's work is ripe for cinematic treatment. He was a very visual writer. There's an abundance of imagery. There's so many films based on this novel. The two I want to just mention are Volker Schlondorf's Spot in Love, made in 1984, and Raul Ruiz's Time Regained, made in 1999. These two just stand out for their efforts to convey the complexities and nuances of the Proustian universe in film language. But as Andre Asiman once said, how do you film time? So it was a bit of an impossible task. But I just wonder whether Luchino Visconti would have made a great job of it. He had a plan to make a film based on Proust, but it just never materialized. Visconti was a Scorpio, fellow water sign, and he had Jupiter-Neptune conjunct in Cancer, which links to this year's great aspect, Jupiter-Neptune, back in April, and again later this year. And he, I think, would have brought a real depth of understanding to Proust, perhaps using music as he did in his other films. But Ruiz's film is unique as well because it uses an unusual technique where the camera just pans around, going from association to association. So it shifts focus almost fluidly. So it could feel strange, but I think this is how Proust would have intended involuntary memory to work. The characters seem to glide from the present to the past and back again, so it has a kind of quantum flavor to the scenarios. Each moment is seamlessly reverberates with other moments in Proust's life. He describes the Madeleine effect, which is the involuntary action of memory that fuses the past with the present like an optical illusion, and that places the perceiver outside time and reduces the fear of the future. Whereas he said, and quote unquote, the images presented to us by the voluntary memory can, it is true, be prolonged at will, for the voluntary memory requires no more exertion on our part than turning over the pages of a picture book. So there's this distinction between the deeper action of memory and the more active part of the mind that can just choose at will. So what emerges is this involuntary memory, which is richer, deeper, far less logical, far more right brain, acting more like a wave than a particle, as in the quantum reality and in quantum theory. So I think the film comes close to that, or attempts to do that, and few other writers can achieve this what I call honorary status of having their own adjective. So now we know what Proustian means. It's to trigger the memory in that way. There's so much to Proust under the surface. The style could be probably annoying for a lot of people, so it's not for everyone. He's still highly controversial because of the way he spoke about sexuality. But I think reading, reflecting on Proust can help you understand the feeling nature of Cancer, and can be almost psychic in its depth. He was that archetypal mother of all within his domain, but it also can help appreciate the magic of Mercury conjunct the Sun for a writer as a gift, which translates very well in his style. There's a complexity of experience in his words. I think it's an experience of the magic perception of love, friendship, social behaviors, death, and all the weirdness of time that he put into this river of a novel. And in these words, you can either drown or find yourself baptized. Henry James once said that a writer should try to be one of those upon whom nothing is lost. And I think this is definitely true for Proust. He was the type of Cancerian upon whom nothing, not any little detail of the life around him, was missed or lost. He wrote it all down. He read everyone as though they were a sheet of music, and he knew how to play it very well, and he captured it all. And I'd like to think that this applies to astrologers too, who go through life using a natal chart to understand people, and just in the same way that Proust used a Madeleine to unlock the secrets of time.
So finally we get to the end, if there is an end. And so I have to thank you very much for listening to all of this and for getting this far. Well done. I hope it's been rewarding in whatever small way, because it's taken me quite a bit of effort to do. You can find the written version on my website, and all the links to the sources are there in the hyperlinks. I've listed the music as well, because I think people might be interested to capture the milieu of all the music that, not just that was played in Proust's time, but that kind of music that he liked. To get in touch with me for a reading, go to www.proteusastrology.co.uk, send me an email, and I'm wishing you all the best for the remainder of the Cancer season. And thank you again, and take good care.